Hi, Sean. Really great to be back on Computerphile. We are in the lab again. I think a few, or maybe about a year ago, you were down here. I can't quite recall if the instrument was running at the time. But what we're actually going to talk about today is based very much on this paper. I wish I could say it's our paper. It's not our paper. It's by a group led by this guy, Alex Calcaturian. Sorry, Alex, if I've got your name, pronounce your name incorrectly. At least you're not stuck with Moriarty for a surname. Interconnected single atoms could make a quantum brain. And we're going to talk about this. There's an awful lot of physics we need to get through. And Sean hangs his head back in pain.
The camera's not drooping, is it? Oh, sorry.
We'll try and condense our physics down. Last video we did, Sean, was on neuromorphic computing, which is about trying to take the type of computing that happens in here, rather than the sort of a Neumann architecture, which is what happens in there, and use that to do processing, because there are certain things our brain does incredibly well that silicon doesn't do so well, and vice versa. When this particular title popped up in my Physics World Institute of Physics feed, it obviously piqued my interest directly. They've basically made neurons out of single atoms, which is really, really quite remarkable. And not only have they done that, they've got single atom neurons, and then they've also controlled the connections between those atoms and the way those atoms talk to each other. So they've also built artificial synapses, again, effectively using single atoms. So this is really quite remarkable. We've got neuromorphic computing pushed all the way down to the atomic level. And that work is based around an instrument called the scanning tunneling microscope. Now, we've talked a little bit about this before. I bored Brady Haran's ears off over on 60 Symbols about scanning tunneling microscopes. This is a scanning tunneling microscope. All the stainless steel surrounding it is because it's in an ultra-high vacuum. We're manipulating individual atoms. We want to have as controlled an environment as possible. We don't want lots of contamination. We're actually working with silicon, and if you were to prepare silicon in air, it'll oxidize in a fraction of a fraction of a fraction of a second. So we have everything in ultra high vacuum at a pressure comparable to that you have in the moon. And actually in real time, what you're seeing here, these are atomic rows of silicon. These little holes are where atoms are missing. And we, along with a number of other groups, have been embedding machine learning approaches like convolutional neural nets. And there have been lots and lots of videos on Computerphile about convolutional neural nets. We've also actually had a number of very helpful conversations with Mike Pound, who I know many of you will be familiar with, on taking machine learning ideas, embedding them into the scanning probe microscope, and instead of us sitting there laboriously preparing that probe, we're training the instrument using reinforcement learning and strategies along those lines to actually get the tip in a state where it gets the best possible image without us having to sit there and babysit it for hours, days, weeks, months on end. In a nutshell, sharp probe, atomically sharp, you bring it in close to a surface, and when I say close, I mean within an atomic diameter or so. The ways and means of doing that, 60 symbols. You move it back and forth, and you measure some type of interaction, be that a current, and the tunneling in scanning tunneling microscope comes from the fact that it's a quantum mechanical effect called tunneling that happens on the atomic scale, or a force. And we're now at the point where you can measure the force, and not just measure, but exploit the force between single atoms. And that's what they've done here. They've imaged and controlled right down to the single atom level. After that long introduction, we're going to talk about this particular paper. And what I'm going to do is try and summarize it down to what the key ideas are. So the paper itself is here, Nature Nanotechnology. An atomic Boltzmann machine capable of self-adaptation. So what's a Boltzmann machine? Well, Boltzmann is an incredibly important physicist, mostly because he thought about the statistics of physics. He thought about matter in terms of its component atoms and the dizzying, bewildering array of gazillions upon gazillions of atoms. You know, try to count up the molecules in this room. So that makes it a statistical problem in terms of how those atoms interact, because, you know, trying to follow the trajectory of an individual atom or an individual molecule, if you have to do that for 10 to the 23, some of you might know where that 10 to the 23 number comes from in terms of a mole of material. If you have to do it for that number of molecules, it's an impossible task. So you think about it in terms of statistics. And that was Boltzmann's genius, was to think about the atomic draw comparisons between, or not draw, comparisons, draw parallels between statistics, the atomic nature of matter, and also how energy is distributed. And that's absolutely key. His ideas were soundly rejected by some of the key figures in physics at the time. Particularly, Boltzmann was one of the first to really accept the reality, as it were, of atoms. He's been vindicated long before those images appeared in terms of the evidence for atoms. But, you know, he would be blown away. We're seeing individual atoms on the screen. We're seeing rows of atoms there. So where does the Boltzmann machines idea come from? Well, the Boltzmann machine idea is really clever. And physicists really like it because it involves taking the ideas from physics in terms of the distribution of energy and feeding that into a machine learning process. In physics, you have what we'd call an energy landscape. The simplest possible energy landscape is think of two hills with a valley in between. We have a ball, it's at the top of the hill, we let go of that ball, what happens? It falls down the hill to get to its lowest energy state. And actually, there are very, very few physics questions that cannot be answered with, well, the system wants to reach its minimum energy state. If you want to use that at a dinner party at some point or in the pub, please feel free to do that. Pretty well any question can be answered with that. Of course, the devil is always in the details, but it's the system wants to get to its lowest energy, or what we call the ground state. You can think of much more complicated landscapes, energy landscapes, with lots and lots of hills and valleys. And it doesn't just have to be gravitational potential energy. If we're talking about atoms and molecules, for example, it'll be a type of energy that describes how electrons behave, which is very much not gravitational energy. And so what we do with a Boltzmann machine is we take that idea of minimizing the energy and we couple it across, or we draw a parallel with trying to find the optimal solution to a problem. So we have a particular energy cost or an energy gain associated with following some trajectory or other. And what we're searching for in both cases is the minimum energy state or the optimal solution. And that's where the Boltzmann machine idea comes from. We're borrowing from ideas from physics and importing those into machine learning. What we want to do is we want to model the brain. What do physicists do? Physicists are very reductionist. And for example, this is a big, wet, squishy thing with lots of very strange, weird stuff happening. So what we want to do is reduce down. So the question to ask yourself is, what do we have in the brain? We have neurons and we have synapses. Could we have a neuron which is basically one atom? So we want something whose state we can change. So
how do you change the state of an atom, though? Is an atom is an atom?
An atom is an atom, but what's inside that atom, inside, are the electrons. So you can change, for example, a really simple way is you could have a potassium atom, or you could have a potassium ion, where you've added or subtracted a charge. Or you can rearrange how the electrons are organized in that atom. You can change the electronic configuration. Leave it neutral, but change the electronic configuration. That's a brilliant question, Sean, because that's exactly what they've done in this paper. They've changed the state of the atom by changing the electronic configuration. Now, so what we have is the possibility of having a one or a zero, but also it can flicker back and forth between those two. It can go 1 0 1 0, or stay in the one state, go to the zero state for a little while, go to the one state, stay to the zero state. These are individual cobalt atoms. We don't need to go into the gory detail of this. What we have here are individual cobalt atoms. What we're imaging here with our scanning probe microscope is actually effectively how the electrons are distributed. So although it's an atom, and you might think of an atom as a little billiard ball, actually what the STM is sensitive to is the configuration of the electrons.
Can you give us a two-sentence what's in an atom for people who haven't, like me, have forgotten?
So the traditional model of the atom, two sentences. Sean, you're asking me for two sentences on the atom?
Look, I've heard physicists like to reduce and simplify.
Yeah. The typical model of the atom, which is called the Bohr model, which is unbelievably wrong, but it's helpfully wrong, is that you've got the nucleus at the center with the neutrons and the protons, and you've got the electrons spinning around outside. It's not how it works. Quantum mechanically, we don't have these well-defined orbits, but we certainly have that nucleus at the center. And then the best way of thinking about it is you've got some distribution of that electronic charge, right, which is effectively like a cloud around that nucleus. What they're doing here is by using the tip and changing the voltage on the tip, they're changing that cloud, that electron cloud. And effectively what you're imaging there is that electron cloud. So they basically have a two-state system. If left to its own devices, it flips back and forth between zero and one, right? So now, with about equal probability, our energy landscape in this case is like that, right? So we've basically got the zero state and the one state in terms of what the atom is. And the configuration of the atom is bouncing back and forth between those two states, which is why you're getting high current, low current, high current, low current, high current, low current. And to use the physicist's term, it's stochastic or it's random. It's bouncing back and forth between those two states. And so in one state, let's say call this the zero state, it looks like this. In the other state, it looks like this. And that's because the configuration of the electrons in the atom is changing. So this is our basic model of a neuron, right? But that's one. So when you bring two of those atoms together, like this, what they then find is that you have a larger number of different current values. Our basic unit, our basic neuron, is a single cobalt atom. And that cobalt atom can be in either a zero or a one state. We're measuring and monitoring what state that is in by looking at how current flows through it from the tip that's above it. The zero state, we get a low current. In the one state, we get a high current. It doesn't matter which way around we label those. Now, when you bring those, bring two of those atoms together, they start to affect each other. They affect the probabilities. And now you've got, instead of having just two choices, you've got two atoms, you've got four choices. They can both be in the zero state. This one can be in the zero state, and this one can be in the one state. This can be in the one state, this can be in the zero state, or they can both be in the one state.
You've got two bits, right?
So effectively, you've got two bits. And indeed, that's what they see. They now see that the current has four distinct levels, or a number of distinct levels. Yeah, four distinct levels, which is what they've plotted out. Then you can add more, and you can add, build up the complexity of your system. But physicists love this idea because A, it links to Boltzmann, and B, it's as reductionist as you get. It's, we've broken it down to single atoms. And instead of all that wet, floppy stuff with gazillions of bloody atoms wildly flopping around in molecules, we've got an atom on a surface in ultra-high vacuum that we can probe right down to, you know, the electronic configuration. That's the type of thing that physicists love. And when that connects to computing, it's really neat. So they've even gone a step further. So that's our neurons. What they've then done is they've basically built in artificial synapses, which is nothing more than an additional atom. And they bring that additional atom in, and that controls the linkages, the weighting of the link between those two neurons. And then they've even gone on further, and they've actually got this thing to learn to some extent, in that it can detect or remember the voltage that's been applied to it by the tip, because that changes the weightings of the connections between the neurons. It changes the synapses so that the system can learn about its previous experiences.
Here and so on. We can't do a lot of interesting things with this image after just one set of convolutions, but we're getting there. So this one is starting to be transformed. Some of them are noisier than others.
That's impurity atoms in that sample. What happens in the real sample is you have a voltage, and that generates an electric